Ham Radio Now, episode 167 from the ARRL and Tapper Digital Communications Conference in Austin, Texas, 2014. This is going to be Bruce Perrins, K6BP, talking about AMBE Exposed, the AMBE vocoder, the other digital voice modes, the ones that we have now, especially for VHF and UHF, and the things that might be coming along if Bruce has his way. So we'll get down to Bruce in Austin in just a minute. I need to point out a couple of things. First of all, the program is made possible by the folks who supported the Kickstarter. There were about 108 hams who made individual contributions to support getting me out to Austin to record everything and then coming back to put it on online. And there were also those $500 corporate underwriters. Those are the folks that are going to get this little plug here at the top of the program. So let's do the plug. Those underwriters are
Adam Curry, John C. Dvorak.
It's Sunday, September 7th, 2014. Time for your Gitmo Nation Media Assassination, episode 650.
This is No Agenda.
Adam Curry is KF5SLN, and he is host of that No Agenda show, along with John C. Dvorak, KJ6LNG. The No Agenda Show is a twice-weekly audio podcast. It takes apart politics, the media, entertainment, anything that needs to be taken out and beaten. You can listen to the program on their website, noagendashow.com, and most podcast apps. I use the Double Twist podcast app. Thanks, Adam. In the morning to you. It's also brought to you by Tapper. They sponsor the DCC, of course. And if you're interested in anything digital in amateur radio, hardware, software, data, voice modes, you will be at home in Tapper. If you're getting a lot out of the DCC videos and you're not already a Tapper member, well, please consider joining. Just stop by their website, Tapper, TAPR.org, and check them out. We're also brought to you by several hams who encourage you to look into hackersforcharity.org. That's a nonprofit organization that leverages the skills of technologists to solve technology challenges for various nonprofits, and also to provide food, equipment, job training, and computer education to some of the world's poorest citizens. You may have some skills that they could use that you would like to contribute. HackersForCharity.org. We're also brought to you by the Amateur Radio Engineering Task Force. They are at aretf.org, and their mission is to make amateur radio networks work better, the digital networks, make them work better by producing high-quality, relevant, technical documents that influence the way people design, use, and manage amateur radio networks. So if you're thinking of doing some digital networking and are looking for some help, they can probably help you out. Maybe you can help contribute ideas to them, too. They're at aretf.org. Finally, we're brought to you by an enthusiastic supporter of Ham Radio Now and Tapper, who wishes to remain anonymous. This ham is a regular attendee of the DCC for over 30 years. If you look in the audience, you see him, but you don't know who he is. I also need to mention now that when I did the Kickstarter, I made a promise that the programs would be available exclusively to the Kickstarter contributors for 30 days before I put them online. And then I didn't do that for the Flex Radio stuff because I thought, well, this is pretty much breaking news and I should get them on right away. But I intended to put the rest of them out late. But when some of the folks that did the Kickstarter contribution saw that I did the Flex Radio one first and right away, they said, you don't need to wait 30 days. You can put them all on as soon as you get them ready. So here's the deal. Tapper, this whole group, their idea is open source, openness. Everything should be out there as best as possible for the community to take advantage of. And they saw no particular advantage in waiting 30 days. I was looking for something that would, you know, you're always encouraged when you do a Kickstarter to come up with some way to give the contributors something special. And I thought, well, there's not very much I can give. The folks that are contributing at $100 or $150 are going to get a little USB drive with some or all of the programs, depending on their level of contribution. There wasn't much I could do for the folks at a contribution level below that, except this 30-day exclusivity. I thought that would be a good idea. Turns out that does sort of go against the idea of openness. I did a survey of the folks that contributed, and the ones that responded, not everybody responded, but the ones that did were 100% unanimous. Put them on as soon as you get them done. We don't need to wait. So I'm going to do that if that rubs a few of you contributors the wrong way and you want to finally tell me something about it. Maybe we'll change that for programs that are yet to come. But for the next couple, they're going to go on right away and we'll see what happens. All right, so that's the deal. Now, let's head back to Austin, Texas, and let Bruce Perens rile up the troops with AMBE Exposed. Steve Bible, some introductions, please.
All right, up for our first speaker, we have Bruce Perens, K6BP for AMBE Exposed. Take it away, Bruce.
Hey, thank you very much. All right. So welcome to the DCC. This is the first technical program. And I am especially happy to be presenting this to our television audience via Ham Radio Now. And as you may know if you watch public television, Ham Radio Now is sponsored by people like you, which means weirdos, okay? I would love to see them do that on Fox. You know, Fox Television is sponsored by people like you, and they put up Rupert Murdoch and the Koch brothers. We're having fun at the conference. I have the wrong thing in this window, so give me a second. Okay, that's much better. So anyway, we went to Congress Avenue last night and saw the bats. And if you have not seen this, there are multiple millions of bats who come out from somehow inside of the guts of the Congress Avenue Bridge at sundown and fly down the river in one direction. And it's all predictable, and apparently this is the peak season for them. They winter in Mexico, and because their H-1 visa doesn't work all year. And so it was really a nice experience to see, and if you can get there at sundown before you leave Austin, it is definitely worth it. Those of you who did not get to go yesterday, it's because you did not invite Bruce to dinner. Because no one else found out. So the pieces are coming together. We are getting the pieces together for the future of SDR-based open platform app using amateur transceivers versus the kind of transceivers that we have now, which are for the most part single-purpose devices. Okay, and single-purpose devices are things that were perfectly fine before the computer age. And as you know, the computer has subsumed the purpose of the telegraph, the teletype, the television, the telephone, etc. And thus, we are going to have transceivers start to look more like really big smartphones. And as you know, we have company here, Flex Radio, that already makes really big smartphones. I've been doing a lot of planning for, well, if we're going to have really big smartphones, well, how are they going to work? So this talk is about including the legacy AMBE-based digital voice systems in the future equipment. And later today, I'm going to talk about the digital voice server. And the digital voice server is the way that we will make the app store for digital voice work. Graham will be speaking, I think, tomorrow about how Flex Radio will provide an open platform for codecs and soft modems within their equipment alongside of their proprietary software in a way that does not interfere between the two or cause nasty licensing problems. And on Sunday, please stay if you can, Chris Testa will teach about the rapid gate array programming environment, which he's used to develop Whitebox, which is the radio modem hardware for HT of the future, which is what I call the direction that we're going. And Chris, believe it or not, programs gate arrays in Python. Okay, so if you want to hear how that is even possible, come to that talk. So today, we have three commercial digital voice systems in amateur radio. So we have D-Star, which is far the dominant one. We have Yasu System Fusion, a newcomer, and DMR Moto Turbo, which is a commercial system. And DMR entered amateur radio because the government is pretty much compelled jurisdictions to go to APCO 25. You don't get that 50% shared funding from the government for your radio infrastructure unless it interoperates with APCO. And thus, a whole bunch of perfectly good $5,000 and more DMR radios, which you paid for with your taxes, are now in the hands of radio amateurs. So anyway, those are the things that we have today. They use the AMBE or the IMBE codec, and I'm working on the next generation. In that generation, it would be really nice to support these legacy systems and interoperate with them. Now, some of you may have realized that this is a rather snotty slide because I'm pointing to the brand new Yasu System Fusion and to D-Star and DMR Moto Turbo and calling them legacy systems. And yeah, that's how development works. So to support legacy systems, we answer some questions about them. Do we have enough technical knowledge to make open source software for those systems? In other words, can we have open source AMBE? Can we do so without running into legal issues? And can we do so supporting them with proprietary software if we can't do it with open source? Do we have to do it with hardware? If you have a DV dongle, that's a hardware device that provides the AMBE codec functionality for you today. And if patents are the problem, when do they expire? So in other words, when do some of these intellectual property problems become over? And we'll start with a very fast primer for those new to the issue and in our television audience who may not have heard five of my talks previously. And those of you who have heard it before, please bear with me for a few minutes. So a digital voice codec is a component used in digital voice two-way radio, and it stands for coder decoder. And what it does is it changes a voice signal from analog audio to digital bits and back. And two codecs in use in amateur radio are AMBE and Codec 2, which I'll both talk about. And the really fun thing about codecs is if you look on an oscilloscope, you can isolate the waveform to a particular number at any point. And if you were doing things the sort of easy or dumb way, you would just say, well, that number is the digital value that we'll have for the audio at any moment. But that would mean that you would be sending over a lot of numbers. And the job of codecs is to take all of those numbers and figure out what we actually need just to understand the speech and throw everything else out. So this is a science called perceptual compression. And it turns out that you can throw away 90% of the information. And the big contest among codec developers is to compress the most effectively for the particular goal, which is in some cases music, so you might have MP3. In some cases audio, so you'd have Codec 2 or speaks. Codec 2 is the lowest bandwidth one, the one that compresses most efficiently that you can get. The military has one that's better. And the way that you generally get AMBE, which is the commercial codec that is in your D-Star radio, is through this chip. And if you'll notice, the logo on this chip is the same shape as the state that we're in at the moment. Isn't that a great coincidence? And so this is actually a general purpose Texas Instruments digital signal processing chip, which has been pre-programmed with AMBE. And then what they do is they blow two fuses within the chip so that you cannot read the code out or you can't modify what's inside. The entire purpose of this chip is to preserve the AMBE intellectual property. The chip is not faster than the CPU in your smartphone or your desktop. It just protects that code from being read by hams who would do things that the company doesn't want them to do. And we hear that newer ICOM radios incorporate AMBE as licensed software. So you can apparently pay to do that. However, you have to sign an agreement that says you will hide that code very carefully and make it impossible for people to read it out. And it costs lots of money that way. It only costs $20 to buy a chip. So where is AMBE? So D-Star and Yasu System Fusion. The chip is manufactured by Digital Voice Systems Incorporated, in other words, DVSI. It's really the work of two developers who've been working on digital speech since at least 1988. AMBE is in APCO 25. It's IMBE in the older versions and AMBE in the second generation, which is now coming out. And none of these systems interoperate with each other, even though they use essentially the same codec technology, which is a darn shame. And here we have the channel spacing. Now, the interesting thing about this chart is that all of these systems do the same thing. They send speech over the radio, and they all use radically different amount of bandwidth to do it. So we have FM, where we're about 20 kilohertz channel spacing. Yasu System Fusion can do 15 kilohertz. DMR can do 15 kilohertz, but they actually get two channels in that because they can switch between two slots. Yasu is two slots, but they can't switch between them. D-Star can use a 10 kilohertz channel spacing. The theoretical codec 2 plus FSK, where this is GMSK or C2FM, would be a 5 kilohertz channel spacing. And the HF version of 3DV, we can easily fit in a 2 kilohertz channel spacing. But unlike all of these others, it requires linear amplification, and linear amplification is less battery efficient. Okay, so that's why we use FSK on VHF and UHF, because it doesn't require a linear amplifier, and we can get more work out of the battery. This is a multi-carrier modem. There's 16 carriers, so there's all this mixing, and you need a linear amp to bring that across. But the important thing about this is here we are, 20 kilohertz. Here we are, 2 kilohertz. Same voice, pretty much, which means that if we use this, we could get 20 times as many channels up here. And as you know, amateur radio doesn't have an infinite amount of frequencies. So actually starting to use digital systems that would let us use more channels is an important thing. So in general, the occupied bandwidth is inverse to the range per watt. Okay, so if we can go down to 2 kilohertz instead of 20 kilohertz, in general, we would get a better range per watt of power. This is all simplification of the math. Battery efficiency increases as the effective bandwidth decreases, so that DMR system has an effective bandwidth of about 7.5 kilohertz, even though it uses twice as much bandwidth to do the two slots. Nonlinear amplification, as I said, is more battery efficient, and this is all hand waving. You could actually prove this to yourself with reasonably simple math. So what's the history of AMBE? The Japanese Amateur Radio League, JARL, designed D-Star and later on worked with ICOM to create commercial D-Star products. JARL chose AMBE for D-Star. Why did they do that? Because there wasn't anything else, really. So the problem is AMBE is a closed system. It's patented, copyrighted, all rights reserved. The binary code is protected under trade secret law. You'll never see their source. The whole premise of amateur radio, though, is to be an experimental and educational service where everything can be hands-on and you can tweak it unless you're Gary, who's an appliance operator, and homebrewing is encouraged. And closed systems aren't really compatible with all of this openness and experimentation and et cetera. And of course, even the people who do happen to be appliance operators profit from all of that experimentation because they get better equipment. And they have people like me to explain it to them. And so, AMBE was actually the first closed system that was admitted to amateur radio as an essential component for interoperation. This deeply offended me and I have for 5 years led the horde of angry villagers against it. Rather than burn down Digital Voice Systems Incorporated, we decided that we would make a competitive product, and as it turned out, it's actually a better product. So maybe someday we kind of kid ourselves, we won't burn them down, but we could actually put them out of business. That's not the case, though. If you've worked in big companies, you know that legacy systems just live forever. So why did Japanese Amateur Radio League choose a closed system? At the time, there just wasn't an alternative, no codec that was good for use with two-way radio at that data rate existed. And I worked for Steve Jobs a long time ago, and I walked into his office as I was actually leaving Pixar one day and said, "You don't buy this open source stuff." And Steve said to me, "Well, you know, I've had a lot to do with making two of the three great operating system desktops in the world, and it took a $1 billion laboratory to make each one." And that was the belief back then, was that it took a $1 billion laboratory to make this stuff. And then we had people like David Rowe, who were one person working without anyone paying him, who made it. And indeed, all these Linux guys made a great desktop too. So we now have a different understanding of how people can make technology and whether you can sometimes do it without the big investment. This is something that's mostly special for software because there's a very small investment required for the physical stuff of making software, really just a laptop. And hardware is actually getting there as we have these things like gate arrays that are programmable. So why did APCO choose IMBE, the predecessor codec to AMBE from the same company, DVSI? Well, APCO Project 25 had a different motivation from radio amateurs, but it turns out that APCO has their own definition of openness. And they required, and this was a surprise to me when I found out, they required publication of the IMBE and AMBE codec algorithms. Okay, so this is a Bruce was wrong moment. There are lots of them. And I have been telling you guys for a number of years that AMBE was a black box. AMBE is not a black box. There's actually a formal specification of how AMBE works out in the public where you can read it. The unfortunate part of it is that AMBE is so patented that reading, it won't actually do you any good unless you are making APCO 25 equipment, because APCO also required that the patents necessary to practice the technology be made available to manufacturers of Project 25 radios on a reasonable and non-discriminatory basis. Okay, so what's reasonable and non-discriminatory? That is not defined. And it may actually be what's reasonable and non-discriminatory to Motorola rather than Mel Witten. So, I'm just assuming you're not as rich as Motorola, Mel. And so this is a way that open source is effectively shut out of stuff like this. Standards committees often use the term reasonable and non-discriminatory. And in this particular case, those terms are only available for making P25, not for making D-Star. Okay, so if you're setting out to make something that's not P25, DBSI can choose to charge you whatever you want. They want for the patents. They don't have to fit any definition of reasonable. So an open source decoder for AMBE, which is called MBE-lib, was developed by an unnamed group using information from the APCO 25 specification and by reading DBSI's patents. And if you happen to be involved with patents, you actually know engineers are told not to read them, because if you read them and then you infringe on them, instead of getting simple damages, you get treble damages, three times. So that was not necessarily the best idea, but that was how they did it. And because those folks don't want to tangle with DBSI and its lawyers, they're anonymous. The authors of this software are anonymous, and they identify themselves using a cryptographic public key. Okay, they actually have a license on the software. I don't know how the heck they'd actually go to court and enforce it while still remaining anonymous. Okay. So we have open source, but actually making use of it for anything but casual home receiving, where it's perfectly good, is problematical. If you followed the earlier days of digital voice, you know that the codecs that they were using back then were copyright infringing. So some people have gotten away from this, and I don't believe, Mel, you've done any jail time. So, you know, it's sometimes possible. So I evangelize the fight for open technology and amateur radio at these Tapper conferences and elsewhere since D-Star came about. David Rowe, VK5DGR, was convinced to create a new codec called Codec 2 based on code he wrote for his 1997 PhD thesis and earlier work. Codec 2 is an open system without patent or even significant copyright restrictions, and you can use it on the air without providing FCC with a reason to believe that you are a person of bad character as a copyright infringer and thus not eligible for an amateur radio license. So although these things never happened, it was kind of important to get hams over to that point, that their operations were actually legal. So who would be interested in AMBE? Now that we have this Codec 2, it's less than half the bandwidth. It's technically superior. It allows your signal to go farther, but we have these historical systems, and a lot of people have them, and they paid real money for them, and they don't want to have it be the case that they can't use them to talk to anyone anymore. So it would be nice to be able to interoperate, not essential, but nice. So where is AMBE going in the future? To understand that, I'll talk about the future of amateur radio. So first of all, there's a new wave in amateur manufacturers. So look at who is doing the innovative work in amateur radio these days. So Elecraft, for example, the K3 and the KX3 are really nice devices. They are nicer than what has come from Icom, Yasu, or Kenwood for the particular application that they do. Flex Radio makes SDR transceivers for end users, unlike Tapper, who makes SDR transceivers for rocket scientists. And it is nice. It is nice to actually put these in the hands of people other than the ones in this room. And then Stepper, if you have not looked really closely at the Crank IR, go and do so. It is just a total work of art. And I will probably never go into the field without that thing again, because it just so simplifies all of the operation of an amateur radio station in the field and does it with tremendously more efficiency over something like a buddy pole, at least at the lower frequencies. So it was really quite impressive. And unfortunately, if you buy it with all of the accessories, it's going to be somewhere over $800. Okay, but the point is we have these little innovative companies, which at least in the case of Flex Radio and I think Stepper, are actually profitable, and they're sort of moving in on the niche of the Icom, Yasu, or Kenwood. And this happens in every generation. When I was a kid, Collins, Drake, and Heathkit were innovative amateur radio manufacturers. Where are they now? Well, Collins got eaten by North American Rockwell and still makes military equipment off somewhere. You know, E.F. Johnson is still around, but they also are no longer in the ham radio market. So we have churn and new guys come along and the big guys go away. And so we can't look to the current big three amateur radio manufacturers to lead with innovative products. New companies establish themselves by doing that. And it's thus no surprise that Yasu made very conservative decisions in making their digital voice system. Now, I promised myself that this talk would not devolve into an anti-Yasu rant because I already have that in the latter part of Ham Radio Now episode 1, 2, 3. So you can go and watch that and see a really first-class rant. And so here are the opportunities for the new wave of amateur manufacturers. So of course, software-defined radio is the first. Radio technology is in transition to software-defined. Software-defined radio is the capability of being changed and improved after it leaves the manufacturer. Okay, that's the key thing about your radio. Your radio should not become obsolete as fast as they do. It should continue to grow the way your smartphone does. You know, you can put new apps on your smartphone. Some of them even talk to you. Will you marry me, Siri? It says something back. And the conservative manufacturers only use this software-defined capability to distribute updates of their own software. And the forward-looking manufacturers make open platforms. And what that means is that you will embrace their radios because they have greater value, because they have this capacity to grow in the future. So apps and open are the second important thing for manufacturers. The consumer is now used to the app store. They buy an open platform, they get the software to run on that platform from third parties. And open source and makers have shown that loosely organized groups can exceed the capability of companies and can manufacture real products that would not be profitable for conventional business. Linux could not have been made by IBM. IBM is too small to make Linux. It was made by a really big group with lots of companies and rocket scientists. And the third thing that's important for manufacturers is the end of modes. Amateur radio is facing the end of modes. Voice, text, and video were formerly their own modulations. These all became just different kinds of data carried over some form of digital radio. And what formerly were modes are just going to be different bandwidths. You know, you'll have one bandwidth for voice and one for television. And those channels will carry different things from moment to moment, just as all of your digital radios, D-Star, Yasuo, etc., they don't just carry voice. They carry geolocation and text, etc. So they're all already multimodal. And while FCC has approved them as radio telephones, they're really not pure radio telephones. And free DV has shown that we can preserve the sport of amateur radio while it becomes digital. And that's important. This isn't the telephone, you know. It's something that we're excited and taking to the edge all of the time. So put all of these things together, software-defined radio, open platforms, and the end of modes. And each of these new manufacturers of amateur transceivers will bring their own ideas to that mix. So Flex Radio is the successful example today. Elecraft sort of is, although Elecraft has not gotten into the open platform thing. So where does AMBE fit in all of this? It becomes an app. All modes become apps. And we're starting to see this with things like DB dongle, and we'll have a talk here about AMBE server DB3000, which is a daughter board for Raspberry Pi that does AMBE. And is it for Raspberry Pi, if I got that right? And okay. And so these are hardware products with AMBE chips in them, but they support apps that run as software. The only reason they're hardware is because of that intellectual property issue. So AMBE becomes a competitor in these future systems among multiple codecs on the platform, some of which are zero cost or technically superior or both. So on an open digital voice platform, AMBE is desirable for interoperability, but no longer essential for operation. We have this problem of digital fragmentation. And what's happened is that each old line transceiver manufacturer creates its own digital fiefdom in which only their own products can operate. And if you have a Google dongle on your television, or the Apple one, or the TiVo one, you're sort of aware of this stuff. You can't get some services without owning the hardware device that's specific for them. And people decided they'd bring this into amateur radio, where IMO, it doesn't really fit. That means in my opinion. And so although every one of these people have said that they will allow other manufacturers to build systems compatible with theirs, the other manufacturers do not take advantage of that offer themselves. They decide, we will create our own fiefdom, not including that other manufacturer. Otherwise, Yasuo would run D-Star. So the way to neutralize digital fragmentation so that all of the hands can talk with each other is for the standard to come from the amateur community. And I'll give you a great example of that. It is the Tapper TNC. All of the manufacturers who decided to make TNCs derived from the Tapper because they were given an essentially turnkey design that they could make without much research. And so all of the TNCs could talk with each other. Now, the alternative was to have a Drake TNC and a Collins TNC. And, you know, obviously the Collins TNC would cost $10,000 and not talk to the Drake. But that didn't happen because of Tapper. So here's the place for people like Tapper to fulfill the same role. So by creating an open source system, 100% open source, and assuring that users will run it as an app on any platform, I hope to seed that community. So can we fit AMBE into that? So we get to a point where it's possible for hams to use software AMBE as an app rather than a hardware AMBE dongle or a daughter board, except for intellectual property considerations. There is a public specification of AMBE and IMBE, perhaps incomplete, but enough for developers to figure out the rest. There's an open source AMBE decoder. The only problem is patents. So this is the public specification of IMBE. It's a, this ends up being an ANSI standard, and you can buy a copy from Global Engineering Documents. You're not supposed to give away copies because it's an old style standard, not the internet age modern open standard. So this is part of the IMBE description. I'm sorry that this is totally unreadable, but some of you wouldn't be able to understand it anyway. 10 minutes? Okay. And the funny thing is they did whatever they could to make this formal description of AMBE mathematically intractable. They didn't describe the way they really did it. So on this page, they describe AMBE in terms of a 16K point discrete Fourier transform. Okay, now if you saw that chip over on slide 3 or 4, that chip on slide 3 or 4 is actually not capable of a 16K point discrete Fourier transform in finite time, you know, given that finite time is one slot of an 8 kilohertz audio signal. Okay, so obviously DVSI looked at the requirement of APCO to do this and said, well, our value added in this is that we actually make it run fast enough for it to fit in a chip. And they took the trouble to describe it in a way that would not work in a chip. And of course, now SDR and DSP and making open codecs is much better known, and we all know how to make this fast now. So this doesn't really help them. And this is the public specification of how AMBE differs from IMBE. And it includes many, many tables like this. It turns out that AMBE uses vector quantization. We actually don't use vector quantization on the HF version of Codec 2 because it's not robust enough. So it was interesting to learn that we could avoid vector quantization and still do better compression than AMBE does. So as part of this public specification, again, we're the reasonable and non-discriminatory basis. You can use these tables. The tables themselves, I don't think, are patentable, but other elements of the algorithm are. Did someone have a question out there? No? Okay, we'll take them later. And it seems most manufacturers, instead of following that specification, they buy their technology from DVSI as hardware or under license. They don't license patents and make their own version. So here's another thing that kind of riles me up. You've already paid for this technology. If you're from the United States, the AMBE technology, at least an early version, was developed under a United States government grant through the Rome Air Development Center at Griffiths Air Force Base in New York. And that's part of the United States Air Force. Obviously, the Air Force wanted good digital audio. You paid for this technology with your taxes. Now you have to pay a second time if you would actually like to use it or anything close enough to be covered by the patents, or be sued or go to jail. My opinion is publicly funded research should be open. We've already paid for it. We should get the advantage of it, and especially the results of publicly funded research should not be used to sue the people who paid for it. Okay? Now, how does this happen in the United States? It's through something called the Bayh-Dole Act. And the Bayh-Dole Act was a way for universities to make money not only through the grants, but through licensing the patents. And so the people on the other side of the argument say that, you know, this funds our universities, but there are downsides. It actually funds the universities with a punitive tax on technology development in the United States. And I could do an entire loony liberal talk about this, but I'll spare you. So DVSI has lots and lots of patents and is busily making more. The most scary thing is they file continuation applications. So continuation application is, we filed this patent 10 years ago, and it really includes this stuff, which we haven't decided to describe until now, and we want the date of 10 years ago to apply to that. Okay, so they can potentially encumber existing technology with new patents. Now, there are rules about that, but actually getting USPTO and the courts to follow the rule that the topic of the continuation patent application must actually be implied by the original application. Getting a court to follow that is very hard. Getting USPTO to follow that is very hard. So potentially Codec 2 could be in danger. David's thesis code is from 1997, and some of his work is from earlier than that. So he has what's called prior art, and we can use prior art to defend it. The key patent on AMBE was filed on April 1st, 2003. In this case, we are the April Fools, not them, and I'll explain why. USPTO tardily granted this patent on January 22nd, 2013, almost 10 years after application. There are certain government guarantees on patents, where if delays go over a certain amount, your patent is extended for one day for every day of bad delay. Okay, so in compliance with that, USPTO granted the patent a 5-year and 51-day extension. This patent will actually be in scope for more than 25 years. And it will expire on May 22nd, 2028. As far as I can tell, I don't believe that AMBE will be useful by that time. That's the whole issue with software patents that I could do another rant on. So can we invalidate this? Can we say for each of the 78 claims in this patent that all of them were invented before, and thus the patent is invalid? Well, there's lots of prior art, including David Rowe's thesis, published in 97, long before their application. The people who made AMBE actually published lots of papers too, etc. So we can conceivably use that prior art to invalidate the patent. We can also use something else called the doctrine of latches. I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. If you have a patent and you know of an infringement, but you wait for the market to get larger before you bring suit, that's a reason for your lawsuit to be denied. And the usual definition of a latches delay is waiting 5 years, although latches cases have been won for as little as a 1-year delay. Codec 2's been around for several years already. The open source AMBE has also been around for more than a year. Okay, so doctrine of latches is conceivably usable to defeat the patent. interesting thing about the MBE lib software, the developers put it out under the BSD license. Another anonymous developer created a proprietary fork called DSD Plus and decided to not to share his source code with the original developers. And that riled up the original developers because they'd put in a lot of work. And MBE lib has remained at release 1.0 for more than a year, I think partially because of this, because somebody really abused the work that these folks did. What one of them said to me was that his user community, which were then using DSD Plus, were actually abusive to him when he asked for the source code to be shared. And he had done the work, and they were actually his user community. This DSD Plus was actually a reasonably small addition to it. And the pain that this caused the developer when he got a public screw you from what was really his user community, who didn't understand where the software came from, demotivated him to do further work. So they know better now, and they will use a license like GPL next time. The public AMBE specification and the working, although imperfect, open source decoder demonstrate that we could provide software AMBE were it not for the patent situation. IMBE, however, the patents on IMBE will expire in a reasonable time, and if we want AMBE to be open, we need to mount a significant legal effort. I believe that my time and the time of other people working on this is better spent on newer and open codecs. I actually don't have as much as 5 minutes, Steve, but I'll take them anyway. And so let's look at the user statistics. There are 33,000 DSTAR users who've registered with an iGate. I hope that's the correct word. It's an internet gate from a DSTAR repeater. Of those, 3,000 are active in any 1 month. And these figures come from dstarusers.org, and I don't know anything about their process, so I can't really stand behind that. There could be active users not in reach of an iGate, and many more hams have dstar capability and do not use it. APCO P25 in amateur radio and Yasuo System Fusion figures are too small at this time to be relevant. So let's look at this economically. 33,000 total users, of which 3,000 are active in a month, do not constitute an economically desirable legacy user community for a business. So future systems where Codec 2 is available and AMBE is potentially an extra cost option are going to have more desirable features than your DSTAR radio. They're going to have apps, they're going to have GUIs, they're going to be smarter than your smartphone. So we think we can sell more of them than there have ever been DSTAR radio sold. And that means we'll have a larger sales base than that which exists for AMBE and amateur radio today. Short runs of AMBE hardware daughter boards, such as the AMBE Server DV3000 card at about $100 or the DV dongle at about $200, can support the legacy user market without significant investment behind them. And conceivably, there could be a community project to invalidate a sufficient number of DVSI's patent claims, but I think I personally will put my energy elsewhere. So in summary, we always knew that intellectual property was the problem. I thought when I started my research that it might stop being a problem while AMBE was still useful and that interoperability would be cheap and simple. Given this date, though, in 2028, it doesn't seem to be the case. It's probably the case, however, that IMBE and DMR Moto Turbo will have the patents expire while they're still useful. I don't think anyone with any sense will include encumber technology in ham equipment where it is necessary for interoperability again, but then I said that before Yasu did it. So thank you very much. I think I have time for a couple short questions. Any questions, please?
Thank you, Bruce. I'm another Bruce, Bruce Elbert, K6ZB. And you talked about codec 2, and you talked about, I think you said it's superior to AMBE. You were referring to a bandwidth efficiency by a factor of 2, I think you said.
Yeah.
But you never really told us about it or described it. Is there a place where we can go for a description to understand a difference?
Ham Radio now has other speeches where I talk about codec 2. And I'm talking about digital voice server later today, and there will also be a little about codec 2. Codec 2 has a website, but the best website to look at the moment is FreeDV, stands for freedigitalvoice.org. And all of the codec 2 source code is online. And I compile it pretty regularly, so I use Linux. You know, most people can compile it. It compiles on Windows, compiles on Macintosh. So if you want to do the ultimate learning about it, you can actually dig through the source code and the algorithms, which is something that you can't do with any other codec of this performance for digital voice. I think it's very important. Educational tool. Next question, please.
Bruce, this is John, K7VE. Just want to clarify that DMR and Moto Turbo actually use AMBE, not MBE. They use the newer specification of AMBE, so just a clarification on this.
Okay, so we're actually talking, that was another Bruce's wrong moment. And we're actually talking in that case about APCO Project 25 Generation 1 using MBE, aren't we? Okay, well, this is what happens from writing your entire talk in an intensive hurry, which is what I usually do. So I have rather write software, you know? All right, thank you very much.